we are not willing to be very flexible at this point.
Oh, I see. Okay, I see. Well, if you don't mind me asking, it's a beautiful home. May I ask why you were selling in the first place?
Well, we were going to go to Florida to be closer to family.
The weather changed that.
Well, we had a deal going. We had a buyer, and they asked us for things, and we went along with it, and we were doing things that they had asked us to do, and we were paying things that they asked us to pay, and then they backed out. And we were we had already started doing things, and we had already started packing, and it was just, it had gotten to the point where we were so stressful that my husband was getting sick. And so we've decided to take a break and forget about the whole thing for a while until we get the price that we want and the conditions that we want.
All right. Thank you so much for downloading today's episode of The Red Pill Investor. My name's Carl Krenzel, here to help you with your real estate sales skills. Thank you so much for downloading today's episode. Today, what we're going to talk about are how home buyers see the real estate market. You know, I've been in the real estate game for an awful long time now, 23 years, and I've been a real estate broker for most of it. And I'll tell you, this is a lot of experience that I've been accumulating over the last couple months. Plus, this is from a website, thenationalmortgagenews.com. And in an article called The 5 Ways Home Buyers View the Real Estate Market, author Elena Tarkazikas, Elena, I apologize if I screwed your name up. She noticed 5 things potential home buyers see as potential obstacles, according to a National Association of Home Builders study. Now, this is important for you and I as practitioners. It's important for you as you and I as investors. It's important for you and I as homeowners to certainly think about how home buyers are reflecting in this market, how they're approaching this market in 2019 and 2020. What are the thoughts that are going through their mind as they're trying to buy a property? And this article, as I've outlined here, comes up with 5 particular articles, 5 particular points, I think, of article that of note that you and I need to take away. So let's just jump with right into them. Point number one says 67% of home buyers do not see their experience getting any easier. A full 67% of home buyers don't see their experience getting any easier. You know, when it comes to finding a property, they don't see it becoming any easier. They see the competition. They see all of the other buyers out there looking for property. They see all the multiple offer situations. There's just a lot of competition, and they don't see it getting any easier as it gets into 2020. So what do you do to help your buyers experience? That's my question to you. As an investor, as a wholesaler, as a realtor, what do you specifically do to help your buyer in this experience? You know, think about it. They're trying to look for property. Everybody's looking for property right now. And what are you trying to do to help them to get better in this experience? Are you finding extra properties in ways that they aren't used to? You know, on one hand, they don't have any confidence that it's going to get much better. And on the other hand, it could also mean that they're not going to wait if a good deal comes up. They don't want to miss out. You know, a lot of the buyers that I've been working with lately have been saying to me, gosh, you know, if we find a property, we're going to make an offer on it. We're ready to go right now. And that is a common mentality. The second thing that the article pointed out that the study discovered, if you will, was that it's the same tired inventory. You know, the buyers out there in the marketplace today are looking at the inventory on the multiple listing service and through Zillow and through all the other portals that they have available to them, and they're seeing the same old things, right? And chances are they're getting the same email drip campaign that, you know, you've been sending them and somebody else has been sending them and some other agent's been sending them. You know, they've been seeing all the same properties over and over and over again. And remember, you set them up on that email drip and they've set themselves up on an email drip from Zillow and some other thing. You know, your job is to go out into the marketplace and shake the trees and make deals happen. I mean, I just don't know how to think about it any other way than that. As a real estate professional, as an investor, as a wholesaler, as somebody who's investing and going out into the marketplace every single day saying you want to invest in the real estate game, well, then you should think of your job as 24/7, nothing but going out there and shaking the trees, looking for deals, making things happen. And when you think about it, as an agent, you need to prospect daily to find new deals. I mean, even if you weren't necessarily investing yourself, let's just say you're a brand new agent, you're looking for business, right? You need to be prospecting every single day, looking for this type of business, looking for people who are looking to sell their property. The third thing, right? Because of this fewer inventory, right? Because it's the same old inventory. Because of this, there are fewer real buyers out there, right? That's the third thing that this study noticed. Now, this is not just me saying it, but maybe you could back me up on this experience, right? When you've been out in the field, let's say in the last 6 to 12 months, have you heard a lot of the buyers out there saying to yourself, you know, that they want to make a lot of extra demands on sellers and then walking away, like we heard in our call? I mean, that's not uncommon. You know, there's fewer real buyers out there. So you want to make sure that you pre-qualify every single buyer that you work with before you spend large amounts of time with them. Right? You want to think about it. You want to pre-qualify them for their motivation. You want to make sure that they're motivated, that they're going to stay in the process, right? That they've got, I don't know, meat in the game, that they got their teeth in it, right? You want to make sure that they're not going to bail on you in the last second. That's your job as a buyer's agent, is to pre-qualify this buyer to ensure that they're not going to ditch at the last second. You have the lender pre-qualify them for their ability to purchase. And you would do well understanding that there's so little inventory out there and that there are so few agents that take the time to go find property that it's going to be difficult for more and more buyers to be out there. They're just going to get more and more disheartened, right? And as they get disheartened, since only 12% of the millennials and 7% of the buyers are planning to buy in the next 12 months, work mostly sellers. That's my advice to you, right? Find sellers. Look for people who are looking to sell and tell them the ways that you can help them make more money. Listen, everybody thinks it's a commission game. Everybody thinks it's the one who can lower his commission the lowest is going to be the one who gets the business. And that's not ain't necessarily so, as the song used to go, right? But the reality is, the one who can get the deal closed. Okay, I like to tell my sellers this. Anytime you decide to put a home on a property, any fool can put the home in the market, place it in MLS, place a sign in the yard, and pray that it will sell and go play golf, right? That's the 5P method of selling real estate. But in order for you to get a contract successful, anybody can do that, but to get it closed, that's another matter altogether. And that's what you need to be promoting as a real estate agent, especially as a real estate investor, is your ability to pre-qualify buyers who are not, repeat, not going to back out of the deal. And if you are an investor, if you're a wholesaler, if you're somebody who's out there in the marketplace, you want to make sure that you're promoting the fact that you don't back out. What is the thing that makes Opendoor and OfferPad and Zillow so attractive? They don't back out. Right? They don't back out. They don't. It is very rare for them to back out of a property. That's what they pride themselves on. You can make plans knowing you're going to close on a certain date, and because you close on a certain date, then that's what makes you their competitive proposition, right? So for you, what can you do to shorten the closing date, to make things more sure, to make them understand that you're a good deal, a good bet, right? Think about it this way. Point number four, when seeking a home, people prefer existing over new construction. Yeah, this new study that the National Association of Home Builders put out, they discovered to their surprise, a lot of people prefer existing homes as opposed to new construction. You know, they thought to themselves, well, gosh, why is that? Well, many times the reason why is because new homes cost more than an existing home does. There's, even in your area where you live right now, there's not a lot of properties that are being built as first-time home buyer homes. New construction for first-time home buyers, not a lot of it. Not nationwide. Oh, yeah, there's plenty for second and luxury home builders. Lots of starts there. But when it comes to first-time home builders, not too many. And that is what's causing a lot of this furious buying spree, right? New homes cost more. There's less of a lot. They're in a master plan community. They're closed in. A lot of buyers just really do not prefer new construction, which puts existing construction at a premium, right? Baby boomers prefer existing housing. They prefer the yard. They prefer, you know, a place for the dog and a nice kitchen, a big house, not too many people close to you. They prefer that. While millennials, surprise, surprise, many of them still have PTSD from 2005, 2006, 7, 8, when their parents lost their house. And they don't want to have anything to do with an existing home. Praise God. They don't want to have nothing to do with it. They want only new construction. Millennials, most of the time, want new construction. The fifth thing that this study found was that there were limited options. Just limited options for home buyers. You know, as home buyers look into the future, into 2019 and 20 and beyond, they don't see it getting any better. They see that it's just going to be a lot more hassle. There's just going to be the same old tired inventory. There's just really, why buy a house if it's going to be this way? And when we do buy a house, we might as well buy an existing home. And then the fifth thing, when they do buy an existing home, or there's just not much homes to choose from. There's just not much out there. And what there is out there, they can't afford because the prices have skyrocketed. You know, there's a lot of searching going on, but 80% that were in this survey, 80% could afford fewer than half of the homes for sale. 80% of the buyers that were surveyed could afford half of the homes that were for sale, and only 20% could afford to look at at least half the homes for sale. What does that tell you? That means that there is a price war going on and a beauty contest. That's what's going on. And if you've got a listing, if you've got a property, if you've got a home to sell, okay, this is the time that you need to sell it, all right? Because there's not a lot of properties available, and it is a price war in a beauty contest with hover buyers. Hover buyers. Now, a hovering buyer, I'm not sure if you're familiar with that. This is Labor Day coming up, right? And Labor Day weekend. Right now, there's people making plans for a barbecue or whatever on the weekend. And what's going to happen is they're going to sit around and they're going to be on the barbecue talking one friend to the other. And he's going to say, well, gosh, you know, how's the home search going, Bob? And he says, well, you know, we lost out on a home. It didn't really work out too well. And he's going to say, well, what do you mean? Well, we made an offer. We made a full price offer, and we asked for the seller to pay 3% towards our closing costs. It seemed pretty reasonable. It was the first day on the market. We didn't anticipate that there would be any problems, and lo and behold, there was three other offers that came in within 12 hours, and we got beat out. They didn't even do a multiple counter offer. His friend says, what? They didn't even do a multiple counter offer. That's unheard of. I mean, when we bought our home back in 2004, when things were skyrocketing, they at least gave us a multiple counter offer. Not so much anymore. No, turns out this time they decided not to give you a full price counter offer or a multiple counter offer because it was just a lot easier to take the cash one they had on hand. Conclusion. Guys, what this means for investors and home buyers and homeowners and people who are in the real estate market is you need to be extra cautious about working with buyers. You need to be extra cautious with the buyers that you're working with and ensure that they're qualified, right? Spend qualified time with them because they're going to buy. If they're a qualified buyer and they're highly motivated, chances are they're going to buy, and they're going to buy right on the spot. They're going to buy very quickly. So spend qualified time with them. Realize that if they're serious, they're going to move very fast, and don't mess around with offers, right? Don't mess around. Get to the point very quickly. As I mentioned in my example, you could lose an offer very quickly over something very trivial. Something like that could happen. So don't mess around. Get straight to the point. Shorten that closing timeline. Make the closing timeline as short as possible. Try to get everybody in the decision-making process quickly so they can make decisions fast, so other people won't come in and so their other problems won't come in, right? Increase your earnest money deposit. When you're trying to buy a property and you find yourself in competition, increase your earnest money deposit. Active buyers want active sellers. That is a gospel truth, right? Active buyers want active sellers. And you as an investor, you as an agent who invests, you need to be out there in the marketplace every single day looking for an active buyer and an active seller and trying to put them two together. Next, there's a growing distaste in the market for wasting time. Even as you sit through this podcast, you find it very difficult to listen to my words because time is asking for you. There's things and notifications on your smartphone and others who are pressing for that moment of time. What I'm here to tell you is that if you feel that same way, chances are your buyers do too. So have a bias for action. Have a bias for action. Take action and take massive action now. Thank you so much for listening. If you have any referrals for the Tucson area, I'd love to help them. And as always, have a powerful day.